Good morning, Zion Church.
Good morning.
It's good to see you this morning. We're going to have a wonderful time worshiping the Lord together. First of all, I'd like to welcome all of those who couldn't be with us but are online this morning and watching us. We pray that you have a worshipful experience right there at home, in your living room, or wherever you might be. And just make a comment if you're online this morning. Let us know that you're there so we'll know what you're thinking, and we'll know that word is getting out to people even on the internet. If you would, take those red folders from the pew in front of you and fill those out, pass them down. You know, I've gotten some really good news this week. There's lots of our people that have been out because of COVID that are now getting their vaccinations and are coming back to church in the next couple of weeks. So it's really a sign that things are beginning to turn a little bit, and we'll be seeing some of our the old faces that have not been able to, I shouldn't say old faces, young faces. Mine's old. Some younger faces that haven't been able to be with us in a while, and I'm looking forward to that. We're going to have a sign-up sheet for lunch food for the annual meeting. So, we will need people to help set up and clean up. If you're able to help, please contact the church office. And especially if you could contact after Tuesday. As you probably know, our administrative assistant lost her mother, and that funeral was yesterday, and she will not be in the office tomorrow. I will be, but she will not be in the office, and she's kind of coordinating that. So if you would, if you're going to call in about that, call on Tuesday, and we'll get you down. We appreciate it. Let's all stand up, and you don't have to shake hands, but tell your neighbors you're glad to see them this morning.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. We have a few announcements. As a reminder, Zion Church is continuing to do what they can to help keep our members and attenders safe during the COVID pandemic. We will continue to provide masks and hand sanitizer at each church entrance and on each pew to anyone who would like to use them. We will continue to use baskets for tithes and offerings and not pass the plates. Baskets are located at each entrance of the sanctuary. A reminder that our annual congregational meeting will be held on February 21st. Members of Zion are encouraged to come and vote. We will vote on consistory, the 2021 church budget, and more. Members only can vote. However, it is an informational meeting for anyone who would like to attend. Each February, Zion Church Volunteers delivers Meals on Wheels to our local shut-ins. If you would like to help with this ministry, there's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. There are still routes needing help. Each route takes approximately a half hour. If you are a ministry leader, please submit your year-end reports to the church office ASAP. Thank you. Are there any additional announcements?
Go ahead.
Good morning. We are going to, I am Brittany Miller, so graciously as said she would help me, are going to start children's/youth choir up again. We'll meet this Wednesday at 6:30 in the upper room up there. So all kids from, we do have, I think, a couple kids that are even in preschool that are coming all the way to sixth grade. And even if there's someone older than that would like to come, we would love to have your voice and stuff. So we are ready to roll again and start practicing. So hopefully all those kids will show up. So thank you.
This is kind of a silly announcement, but I'm getting new couches and recliners for the middle school Sunday school classroom, and so I want to offer up the ones that are in there now to anybody that needs a couch, a love seat, or a recliner, because if nobody claims them, then we'll just take them to the dump. So within the next couple weeks, just let me know, or just take them out of the classroom, and they're yours for the taking.
My announcement regards the youth this summer. We've decided to try to take some youth, if we just have even a little bit of interest, to Clydehurst, a Christian camp in Montana. And so if you're in middle school or high school and you'd be interested in that, it looks like a really beautiful area where there'll be some nice Christian activities, but just a lot of fun to be had outdoors. And the camp is where they filmed the movie A River Runs Through It. It's just to give you an idea of how nice I think the camp will be. So in 2.5 weeks is when registration opens. Now we are currently trying to figure out how we can register a group as a whole. We're working on that, but please let me know if you're interested so we can start planning that important summer trip. Though please note that I don't believe Robert Redford will be there. So I don't want you to be disappointed or happy about it, given perhaps your political opinion. So. Also, Mr. Heckert has been using his skills as a carpenter to make what I would describe as just little cribs. Is that right? Really nice wooden cribs. And he has provided those actually for free because he just feels compelled to make them. They look very nice. We have some in the back of the church. And if you think you know someone that could use one, you're actually free to have one. So please, they're very nice. If you can use it, very much consider it.
Plus 2 o'clock, word of voice.
I'm sorry?
2 o'clock, word of voice.
Okay, all right, excellent. So yeah, just consider those in the back. They're free, so we want to thank him for making those and providing that ministry option for people who could use them. Thank you.
Okay, are there any other announcements? At this time, I'd ask that you join me in prayer to the Lord for our opening prayer. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather together and worship. We would ask that you be with Pastor Dobson as he delivers the word and open our hearts to his message and the music as we celebrate you this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. Our call to worship today is from Psalm 18, verses 1 through 3a. I love you, Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge. My shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord, who is worthy of praise.
Please stand with us as we sing our first hymn.
We have heard the joyful song, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land, harvest leaves across the waves. On the
Our scripture readings today come from 2 Chronicles 14, verses 1 through 7, and 2 Chronicles chapter 15, verses 12 through 15. And Abijah rested with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David. Asa, his son, succeeded him as king. In his days, the country was at peace for 10 years. Asa did what was good and right in the eyes of the Lord, his God. He removed the foreign altars and the high places, smashed the sacred stones, and cut down the Asherah poles. He commanded Judah to seek the Lord, the God of their ancestors, and to obey his laws and commands. He removed the high places and incense altars in every town in Judah, and the kingdom was set at peace under him. He built up the fortified cities of Judah, since the land was at peace. No one was at war with him during those years, for the Lord gave him rest. Let us build up these towns, he said to Judah, and put walls around them, with towers, gates, and bars. The land is still ours, because we have sought the Lord our God. We sought him, and he has given us rest on every side. So they built and prospered. 2 Chronicles chapter 15, verses 12 through 15. They entered into a covenant to seek the Lord, the God of their ancestors, with all their heart and soul. All who would not seek the Lord, the God of Israel, were to be put to death, whether small or great, man or woman. They took an oath to the Lord with loud acclamation, with shouting, and with trumpets and horns. All Judah rejoiced about the oath because they had sworn it wholeheartedly. They sought God eagerly, and he was found by them. So the Lord gave them rest on every side.
I love you.
you'd please join me in the Apostles' Creed. Church, what is it that we believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, he descended into death. On the third day he rose again from the dead, he descended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one holy universal Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, Amen.
And please pray with me the prayer our Father taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we forgive our trespasses, as we forgive our trespasses, and lead us not into temptation.
Do you please stand as we worship our Lord? Thank you. to you. May be seated. Or you may keep standing, either one.
Wanted to know some people in particular we'll be praying for this morning. Marilyn Montoya, which she doesn't attend our church, but many of you know her. She had a heart attack on Thursday at school and then open heart surgery on Friday. So we want to be praying for her recovery. We also want to be praying for Heidi's father, Homer Geis, who is recovering from a stroke, but my understanding is recovering well. Okay, excellent, but so nevertheless, want him to continue recovering well, be lifted up and strengthened. We pray for Bob and Melissa Hefenader, of course, Bob is recovering from his open heart surgery, dealing with pain, but he has finally returned home. Things are looking well. He seems to be recovering well, but I have no doubt, even if he is in less pain, it is still painful to have your chest cracked open and then have to heal from that. So, and of course for Melissa, because she is his primary caregiver at this point, and just such a wonderful source of strength for him and an inspiration for me, quite frankly. Also, for the Newell family, want to help so that Tommy can get some answers on exactly what's causing him some issues, and that those answers are all well, and that he can recover well, and that he may not continue to face problems like this, that hopefully we can pray that this becomes an isolated incident. Also, I have a couple families in mind that are involved in our congregation that are just going through some troubling life situations right now, but I believe ultimately God can use it for good. So just because I haven't gotten permission, I don't want to get into specifics, but just want to pray for in general for those. And of course, for many of our families who have suffered loss over the past few months, you continue to be in my prayers and thoughts, and it lingers, but you're certainly well thought of and prayed for, and I'm certain of the Lord's promises. So if you would please join me in prayer. Lord Father in heaven, our mighty King, the creator of the entire universe, who spoke the universe into existence, and then as you spoke, your word, your Son, created all things. Lord, we also recognize that he came and took on flesh and became a man, uniting divinity and humanity in one person. And in so doing, created a bridge for us to have salvation. Because although we are sinners, he is perfectly righteous. And he took our punishment on the cross and then was resurrected to demonstrate that he had overcome sin and death. And so too, through faith in his death and resurrection, we too may have eternal life and an assurance of a resurrection. Lord, we would ask that as your servants, as your children, through faith in your only begotten Son, Father, that we be strengthened to spread your gospel and to do your will in this world. For tough times may be coming for the church, Lord, but we're also excited about your promises and to see your Holy Spirit manifest and do incredible things during difficult times, as he always does, Lord Father. So we want to thank you for your power and your promises. Lord, we would also ask that you please help Marilyn Montoya recover after her open heart surgery and help comfort her and her family. Help them to draw near you and trust in your Son. Heal them and strengthen them, Father. Lord, we also ask that you continue to heal Homer Geist, but also thank you for helping him recover well so far. We ask that you continue that and build him up and strengthen him and keep him around for quite a while and use him well and just demonstrate your grace and power in his life. Lord, we also ask that you please be with Bob and Melissa Hefenader as Bob is recovering from his surgery. Thank you for helping him to do so. Thank you for giving those surgeons the skills to be able to help him with his blockages. And now we ask that you take over, be that great physician, heal his body, and continue to use him as just a touching person. He's been a man of our lives, just a quiet man, but when he speaks, it's always an important word, and he's just a source of strength and a good example for so many of us. So we ask that you continue to use him in that way. And Lord, we want to thank you for Melissa, strengthen her, but thank you for her incredible service to so many people that she doesn't even discuss, but we know that many of us know the kind of service she does for those in the community. We just want to thank her. So thank you so much for her as a great servant. So please give her strength right now as she cares for her husband. Lord, please be with the Newell family. Please comfort all of them during this time when their patriarch has some health issues. But Lord, we are hopeful that you can help provide answers to Tommy and Laura regarding Tommy's condition, and so that it can be addressed. And we would ask that you restrain the sickness in him and help alleviate it from him, help him find the answers and help heal his body and lift him up, and to continue to use him well, Lord. Continue to use him as just a great example of one of your servants and continue to build him up in that regard and just bring some peace of mind to his family during this time of just uncertainty, Lord. Just let them find supernatural peace and comfort and trust in your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask that you please place your blessing upon this service. Use the words we hear ultimately, allow them to be from you, place them within us, and use those words to conform us into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray, amen. And now, I would like to say that you are dismissed for Children's Church.
Please stand as we sing our offertory hymn.
Start with something funny, but you would have been here early for the funny part. Real early. I was coming across from my house this morning and I hit kind of an icy spot right at the rail out there. And my feet just started going out of control, and I grabbed the rail, regained control, took one step and went whack. I didn't hurt myself. You believe me, I laughed so you can laugh. There's a part of last week's message that I just want to back up and catch because I think it's so important. And it has to do with 2 Chronicles chapter 7. So I want you, if you will, to turn in your Bibles to 2 Chronicles chapter 7. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. We're going to start in verse number 11. This ties in with what we were talking about with Solomon last week. But it is so important to what we are facing as a nation now. And if we're going to see revival stronger than ever, if we're going to see God's wisdom, if we're going to see change in our nation, this is the key to change. Starting with verse number 11, chapter 7 of 2 Chronicles. When Solomon had finished the temple of the Lord in the royal palace, he had succeeded in carrying out all that he had in mind to do in the temple of the Lord and in his own palace. The Lord appeared to him at night and said, "I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a temple for sacrifices." Now listen to this. "When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain." Who's talking there? God's talking there. when I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land. That's just another word for grasshoppers. Have y'all ever, I know the farmers have seen when infestation of grasshoppers take over, how devastating it can be. We used to, in East Texas, where I was on James Robinson's property for so long, we had over 700 acres of coastal Bermuda hay. It's not a type of hay that you see up here, but it is used a lot in the South. And I woke up one morning getting ready to cut a field, a 40-acre field, and that 40-acre field was nothing but stems. It was gone overnight due to grasshoppers. I mean, just wiped it out. Now, in our day, you go get pesticides, call the airplane, have them come over and spray, and hopefully you rid yourself of the grasshoppers. Think about them. They didn't have a way to call for an airplane to fly over and kill the locusts. So listen to this. Or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague, COVID, among my people. Now here's the key. If my people, who are his people? We are. Who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attended to the prayers offered in this place. I have chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will always be there. If my people, who are called by my name, I hear so much talking going on about, well, if the Democratic Party would do this, if the Republican Party would do this, if these people would do that, if this group would just stop this, if Antifa would quit burning stuff down, and I'm not in disagreement with a lot of those things, but here's the deal, folks. God's not calling on them to change their hearts. He's calling on us to change ours. If my people who are called by my name, number one, will humble themselves. You know, I've had to ask myself at times and have gotten not an answer that I really like, but I've asked the Lord, you know, surely there's not any arrogance or pride in me. Guess what? I found out that there was some pride and arrogance in my life. And that's something that I have to constantly keep a check on and let the Lord check my heart constantly to see that there is no pride, no arrogance in my heart. Because when we are a prideful people, guess what? His ears go like this. They're shut. If you don't believe me, read it. I mean, it's plain as day. And seek my face. You know, we got this discussion in Sunday school this morning about how a lot of the big C church world today is seeking God's prosperity, but not seeking God's face. You know, God's face, when you look at God in the face, if you're really wanting to get intimate with God and you spend time seeking his face, that intimacy between you and him will change your life forever. It goes from being something that you know about up here to something that captures you in here. It's radical. It's actually fun. But he's talking about the very kind of things that we are going through as a country. locusts devouring our land. Man, we've seen more weird weather in the last few years, floods in places that have never flooded before, and all kinds of different, just out of the ordinary stuff going on in the realm of weather, and making it hard for farmers with their crops. And now we have a plague going on in our country that is worse than any that has been seen probably since polio. How many of you remember polio and polio vaccines? Well, a few of you are as old as I am. He says clearly, seek my face, and if my people will turn from their wicked ways. He's not even calling for the world to turn from their wicked ways. He's saying, church, turn from your wicked ways. Surely we don't have any wicked ways among us. We're good people, aren't we? You know, we have to go back and look at in different places to see what God considers wicked. If we go back in the book of James, and I don't have time this morning because I've got to move on. But in the book of James, we find out that any sin is wicked in God's eyes. He even turns his face away from sin. Just can't look at it. And that's really what we've been talking about the last few weeks, is knowing when it's time to repent, when it's time to seek God's face. And today is no different. And I wanted to get this passage of scripture in before we start on the actual sermon this morning. And I promise that I'm going to keep it short. But this is so important, because if we want to see our land healed, if we want to see COVID rid from our land, I do believe that the answer is prayer. Yeah, I'm all for the vaccinations. If you're for them, great. If you're not, great. I'm all for social distancing and all the things that we have to do. But the real answer, according to the Word of God, when a plague is sent on our land, is prayer. Seeking God's face, his people humbling themselves. And then here's the beautiful part. Then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land. I'm looking forward to that time, aren't you? Now, I want to get on to what we're going to talk about this morning. The reign of King Asa. I'm not going to spend a long time, but there's some things that I feel like we need to talk about this king this morning, and what he did and how it has an effect on our lives. There's really three chapters in 2 Chronicles that deals with King Asa and his reign and his life. And we start with chapter 14. And we see some things in chapter 14 that we don't see in chapter 15. And then we see some things in 15 we don't see in 16. So there's three chapters, 14, 15, and 16. And I encourage you sometime just to read the whole chapter. But Ezra is trying to teach us that renewal of a nation comes when its people will seek the Lord together, just like I was reading in this passage before. And because Asa was fervent for God, because he was seeking God with his whole heart, an entire country saw change. An entire country saw God absolutely turn things totally around for them. And if you look at chapter 14, you will see, and I'm not going to go to the specific verses this morning, but they had a million-man army that was coming against them to wipe them out. Have you ever felt like things were closing, shutting down on you? Like you may not have a million men army coming against you, but you feel like that you just one more thing and that's all I can take. I just about can't take what I've got on my plate now, and God, don't give me one more thing. Well, these guys are looking in the, they're sending their scouts out, and they're finding this million man army, and they've got all of these chariots lined up, and they're gonna come wipe them out. Everything that they know, everybody that they know, all of their land, all their belongings, all their families are gonna be completely wiped out. So, what do you do when you feel outnumbered like that? You better call on God. One of the things that we're going to learn here is that you can always count on God. He is faithful. Even when we're not, He is faithful. We just saw that. If my people who are called by my name will pray, I will heal their land. In chapter 14, there are three lessons that are basically learned in these three chapters. The first one in chapter 14 is the rout. God absolutely routs this army and absolutely wipes them off the face of the earth. And they could not have done that without God's help. It was not something that they did by their own strength, because they didn't have the men, they did not have the ability, they did not have the tools, they did not have the chariots to outnumber them. They were going to get their backside whipped, and they knew it. But because of God, God wiped that army out. And it's such a beautiful picture of a New Testament passage. He can supply all your needs according to His riches in glory. Asa didn't need to have everything that he thought it would take to wipe out that army. He just needed God's strength. And he can do the same for you. He can, whether it's a physical need, whether it's a financial need, whether it's just hearing a word of encouragement. I cannot tell you how many people that I talked to, especially in the last 3 months, who are just looking for a word of encouragement. And I can't be every place. But you can. You can be more places than I can. Offer a word of encouragement to people. Let them know that God will fight for them, fight their battles, and they can win. That's such a beautiful lesson for Asa. He was, you know, they had lost their way, and they had been worshiping false gods. And so on the way back from seeing this army wiped out, they tore down all the Asherah poles. They tore down all of the idols and all of the altars that were had been built to false gods. And they built altars to the one true God, and they turned their backs on all of these idols and said, we're going to worship the one true God. And Asa made quite a commitment on that. In fact, he said, if you're not going to follow God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, get ready to have your head lopped off. I mean, that's basically, he said, if you're going to be a part of this kingdom, you will follow the Lord. Boy, if we did that today, I mean, if we were to try to push Christianity like that, my. Coming a day when we're going to have to be able to stand and fight Christians, because it's no longer going to be easy to be a Christian in this country. Now, in chapter 15, we see the next lesson. The rout's over, and Asa and his men are returning to their homes and families. And on the way, the Lord sends them this prophet, Azariah, to encourage them. And I'm not going to read the passage, but if you wanted to, it's found in starting at verse number 1 and goes through a big portion of that chapter. But Asa really thought about what we know as the first commandment. I am the Lord your God, and you will have no other gods before me. And as I said, Asa sends a wrecking crew to tear down the pagan worship centers. And then listen to this. This is so cool. The third month of the Jewish calendar. And if I'm wrong, you can correct me on this. But I believe that's late May and early June. Is that right? Somewhere in there. That's the Feast of Pentecost. And normally the sacrifice at the Feast of Pentecost was 7 bulls and 2 rams. Asa, because of this great thing that God did for him, you read this in verse number 11, brought to the Lord 700 cattle and 7,000 sheep and goats to sacrifice to the Lord. He did 1,000 times more than what God was asking. Why? Well, remember when David was asked to build an altar to the Lord, he did more than he was asked. Solomon did the same thing. Now we see it happening with Asa, that he does 1,000 times more than he was asked. That's because they love the Lord their God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength. Verse 12. I am going to read this verse. Then they entered into a covenant to seek the Lord God of their ancestors with all their heart and all their soul. Whoever would not seek the Lord of Israel would be put to death, young or old, man or woman. They were serious, weren't they? They took an oath to the Lord in verse number 14, in a loud voice, with shouting and trumpets and with ram's horns, and all Judah rejoiced over the oath for which they had sworn it wholeheartedly. Chapter 15 is a lesson of revival. Man, they're having a party because they have come back to the Lord, and the Lord has blessed them mightily. When people turn their hearts totally over to God and can say this with all honesty, that they're seeking the Lord their God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, that's revival. That's when even the little C church, our church, would see revival. That's when the big C church, the church across our country, will see revival. When people will seek the Lord with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength. I hope you're praying for revival on a national level, because God knows we need it, and we need it now. Can you imagine, like some of the revivals of old, people coming to God by the thousands? I can see that, and I so want it to happen, and I want it to begin here. Matt and I talked about this. You know, there are more lost people in Moreland than there are saved people. We've got a mission field right here under our noses. Wouldn't it be cool to see these people start coming to Christ? Ezra is teaching that the renewal of a nation comes when its people seek the Lord together. Now, like all of us, King Asa, during his reign, begins to let things kind of slide a little. And 25 years after the revival, the northern kingdom under a king named Baasha begins to threaten the southern kingdom. And in order to stop this migration of his people into Judah, Baasha starts to build a border wall. And this wall wasn't to keep people out, it was to keep people in. This is verse 6, chapter 16, verse 1. In the 36th year of Asa, Israel's king Baasha went to war against Judah. He built Ramah in order to keep anyone from leaving or coming to King Asa of Judah. Ramah was just 5 miles north of Jerusalem. And it was on the main road that everyone traveled. So Asa figures that he can get by with doing this. He brought out silver and gold from the treasuries of the Lord's temple. Did you hear me? From the Lord's temple, he brought out silver and gold and sent it to King Ben-Hadad, who lived in Damascus, saying, and this is in verse number 3, "There's a treaty between me and you, between my father and your father. Look, I have sent you silver and gold. Go break your treaty with King Baasha so that he will withdraw from me." What is wrong with what he's doing here? He's depending on the strength of man and not on the strength of God. Asa, once filled with absolute passion for God, is now kind of rocked into leisure. Instead of trusting God and leading his people into battle, he pays somebody else to do his fighting for him. You don't do that. So the lesson in chapter 16 is rebuke. God will make you strong, and he will show himself strong on your behalf if you will call on him. He will fight your battles for you. He will stand with you. This is the primary lesson that we learn from Asa. Is, man, he knocked down a million-man army for you, and then you come up against this one little problem, and instead of calling on God, you call on, you actually take money out of the treasury of the temple and try to buy your way out of trouble. And God was not happy. And it led to Asa's ruin. It's so important for us to see that we need to commit our ways totally to the Lord. Out of this, are you willing to do the seven bulls and two rams? Or are you willing to do 7,000 and do it 1,000 times more than God asks of you? What are you willing to do for God? What are you willing to sacrifice to say that you're going after God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength? I have to admit, there's been times that I've been like Asa, man, where I've been on fire for God. I've seen God do some amazing things in my life. And then there's other times you know, our family is going through some stuff right now. I'll tell you guys this. Diana's parents both have COVID right now. And her mom has extreme breathing problems. Bless her heart, I hope she's not watching this morning because she'll shoot me for telling all this. But she needs your prayers. But even things like that begin to wear on you. Some of you have been through the same thing. You've had family that have been sick. Some of you have lost family and friends. And it begins to wear on you. It begins to pull on you. And your whole heart is not going after God. It's consumed in worry, fret, fear, doubt. And yet God's got the strength to wipe out a million-man army for you if you will just call on him and let him do it. Are you willing to call on the Lord? Are you willing to ask Him to fight your battles for you? Or are you going to try to strong arm it and do it yourself? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the lesson of this King Asa that we don't hear a lot about. We're thankful that he had the ability to give himself wholeheartedly to you. And he also gave us a lesson of the end of his reign that if you're not careful, you can get kind of leisurely and start depending on your own strength instead of God's strength. Lord, help us that if in any way we're depending on ourselves and not you, that we would seek your face, we'd humble ourselves, turn from our wicked ways, so that you can heal our land. Lord, we love you today. We thank you for the truth of your word. Now we ask that you apply it to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand as we sing our benediction song.
Jesus, we just want to thank you.
Let's turn our attention to the prophet Azariah's words to Asa. Listen to me, Asa, and all Judah and Benjamin. The Lord is with you when you are with him. And if you seek him, he will let you find him. But if you forsake him, he will forsake you. Now, we can apply this as a principle for us in the body, in that we can certainly offend the Holy Spirit. And it doesn't mean that he's left us, because he indwells us as believers. And yet we can offend him enough that his power over us is so diminished that we're no longer useful. So let's cleave to the Lord. Let's rest in him. And if we seek him and try to get close to him, he will strengthen us and make us useful in this world. Please go in peace.